A day begins. In the crowd, each man seems much like another. We hide behind routines and uniforms. But one man, in one of these grey suits, is different.
Take camera cue.
Good morning. There's been an explosion at Paddington Station in central London. The blast occurred at 4:30 this morning. There were no injuries. Anti-terrorist officers are at the scene. Unconfirmed reports say a small bomb exploded between
seven
two platforms.
And white. Take camera cue.
President Bush refused...
Ronnie was born without arms, damaged by the drug thalidomide, a tranquilizer taken by his mother to relieve morning sickness during pregnancy.
From Washington, David Foster.
Ronnie is not alone. Elaine is starting her day.
I knew I was different after all other children used hands and they had arms, and I used my feet. So I was aware that I was different, but not in the terms of it being a handicap or a disability.
Tom is a member of a generation which worldwide numbers 8,000. Overall, thalidomide victims can be found in 46 countries, with the largest proportions in Germany and Japan. This generation is unique. Because they're not genetically damaged, they cannot reproduce their deformities.
In about 60 years' time, thalidomide people will be extinct. We'll go down in the history books as a generation of people that will, or at least should, never appear again. And we're just a blip in the history of mankind.
Although medically, the thalidomide generation are connected, this unique tribe rarely meets, because most of its members don't want to.
Yeah, perhaps I'm a bit prejudiced towards them. I don't really know, especially if I see somebody like myself. Now that, I must admit, I find very, very difficult, because in my own mind, I'm normal.
Not all the tribe looks alike. For Kevin, neither his arms nor his legs develop properly. There are currently about 450 thalidomides in Britain, and 35 of them are forelimb deficient, like Kevin. Life for Liam is a dark confusion. He's nearly blind, and because he has no roof to his mouth, he cannot speak. For some, thalidomide touched a thumb, but for others, the drug in its dreadful inequality granted a half-life. Philippa is nearly 30. What has the passing of time meant to the thalidomide generation? The tribe, unmade by man and forced to do things differently.
What are you going to call your programme?
I was going to call it 30 Years On.
That's pretty boring. I mean, if it was me, I'd call it something like The Tin Lids. The Lids, get it? Well, I'm in Cockney slang.
James, the baby who never has nappy rash. His mum knows that nothing protects his skin better than Vaseline petroleum jelly.
Mothers have an image of the baby they want. For the parents of 1960, these were the visions of perfection.
I was very, very sick during the first two pregnancies, and so when I realised that I was pregnant for the third time, I thought I'd go along and see if there's anything new that I hadn't tried before.
So the doctor said to me, here you are, Sheila, because we're on first name terms, and known him since we were a kid, try these. Let me know what you think of them. He said, they're great, stop you being sick.
Nobody would have given it a second thought. It's like going to the cupboard and taking a couple of aspirins, isn't it?
In fact, I even went back and took more. They were given to me. I found out later they were called Distival.
The drug thalidomide had been developed in Germany, and was distributed in Britain by the Distillers Company, who also marketed Scotch whisky. It was sold under the brand name Distoval as the ideal tranquilizer with no unpleasant side effects.
Towards the end of the pregnancy, I did feel that things were different from the previous two times.
I felt something was wrong, but I couldn't... Nobody could say what was wrong. It was just an instinctive thing.
The thing with this pregnancy was that the child appeared to be so hyperactive to cause me real physical discomfort that I hadn't had with the other two. In fact, at one time I was told this child is all arms and legs.
A new baby is a symbol of hope. Pregnancy is meant to end with good news.
And he said, "Mr. Mason," and he put his arm round my shoulder, and I just looked at him and said, "Is my wife all right?" He said, "Yes, your wife is fine. Would you like to come into the office?" He took me in, sat me down and said, "Your wife is 100%. And I said, "The baby?" He said, "It's a girl, but I'm afraid she wasn't quite ready to be born."
I just couldn't believe what he was saying or comprehend it. So I said, "Look, tell me what it is." And he said that she hasn't got proper arms and legs.
And the sister came along and said, "Would you like to see the baby? He's gorgeous." And I said, "No, I just couldn't see him. I'm terrified."
I looked, and obviously I was extremely shaken. I couldn't believe my eyes. I mean, her arms and legs were virtually non-existent, and her feet and arms were like little sprouts on the side of a torso.
One arm looked like a crab's arm. You know, it was so fat and flabby and jelly.
Her father went in to see her because, of course, she was born during visiting time. And all he told me that she was bloody horrible. He went home, and my dad said, "Well, what she had?" He said, "It's a girl." So he said, "What do you mean, it?" He said, "Well, that's all it is. It." He said, "It's bloody awful."
Thoughts tumbled through my brain. I asked the doctor, I said, "Well, where do we go from here?" And the nurses sort of closed in a protective ring around the cot, wondering what I would do next.
And I found that experienced staff, doctors and nurses, were absolutely horrified, didn't want to see them, didn't want to go and treat them. Psychologists didn't want to go and test them. And the whole of my unit went into a sort of state of mourning at first.
The trauma of deformity is the trauma of conflict. Our culture demands we suffer any child, however grotesque. But our biology would kill it, not care. So nature fights against nurture.
If you look at animals, they have deformed offspring as well. And the pattern is one of rejection. A deformed baby animal is either pushed out of the nest, or some animals actually eat their deformed youngsters. So that there is a very deep-seated and long-standing tradition, if you like, of abnormal newborns being rejected.
But the pattern of rejection was not simple. David Bickers was severely handicapped, but was loved and accepted. Yet others, far less damaged, were rejected.
And some parents couldn't accept the slightest blemish in their child. Maybe just a missing earlobe, or a hand that was deformed, or a clubbed foot. One of the mothers, I remember, told me that she was a dancer, and that everything was in her hands and the movements of her arms and her hands. And when she had a son without arms and hands, she said, "I could never communicate with him. He'll have to go to an institution."
When a disabled child is born, you know, it's a tremendous threat in every way. It's a threat overall to the normality of life, but perhaps I can be more individual and more specific over it. Initially, it's a threat to your manhood, to your genes, to your normality as a person that you could have possibly produced, you know, a deformed child. That's the first threat. Secondly, it's a tremendous threat to your marriage, to your relationship with your wife. I mean, this is also well documented because the divorce rate and marriage failure rate amongst thalidomide parents is tremendous. It's also a threat to the normality of your social life. All these things crowd in on you.
The verdict in the thalidomide trial in Belgium, that not guilty, announced among scenes of such wild enthusiasm, must have been the subject of...
This crowd offered sympathy to a Belgian mother who, having poisoned her baby daughter with the help of the family doctor, was acquitted of murder after a weeks-long trial. The conflict of deformity produced extremes of response. Utter rejection from one mother, but complete bonding from another.
I just picked her up, and she smelt lovely, but what did it? She couldn't put her arms around my face, but her head, somehow she seemed to nuzzle it right into the nape of my neck and bury herself between my chin and my shoulder blade. And that was it. That baby was not going anywhere. Everybody else could go where they wanted, but the only place she was going was home with me.
So then the paediatrician came to see us. We were both sat there and terribly upset about it all. So he tried to explain about our daughter and that he would advise us to have her put into a home. And at that stage, I'm afraid my husband lost his cool and went to hit him because he said, hang on a moment, you know, there may be a disability, but we don't just give away our child like that. And he was very angry with him. And the paediatrician was so taken by that, he actually cried and was very moved by the whole thing with us being there and how we were feeling. And how I, like I told you, I had said how Rosie looked so lovely.
And I've been told that when they handed me to my mum, she said, isn't she beautiful? She's mine. And then after that, she pulled back the blanket and had a look at my hands and my legs and that just didn't seem to matter. I was hers and I was going to be hers forever.
The first casualties of thalidomide were not the thalidomide children. They were the parents. Brett Nielsen's family was strong and supportive, but many marriages failed to survive even the birth.
We have to remember that a handicapped child is a handicap to the whole family. And on the whole, if the child is born into a family that is close-knit, as a close-knit partnership, a close-knit family, then the challenge of a handicapped child will knit them closer and they'll see it as a problem to be dealt with together.
The likelihood of the family breaking up, the abandonment rate of the wife and the child by the father was particularly likely where the fathers were very ambitious. They got a career that they were very keen on and they felt it was going to be damaged by the disgrace because they saw it as a disgrace.
The horror of the birth was the parents' horror. It passed the thalidomide children by. But what did affect the children, and far more fundamentally than their damaged bodies, was the decision their parents made about their upbringing. Tom lived at home with his parents and went to a normal primary school. But in the Mason household, a family grew up without their eldest daughter.
I tried to think why my father thought of me as a threat, and the only conclusion I can come to is that I'm not perfect. He wanted a perfect family, he wanted a perfect wife, wanted a perfect house, wanted a perfect job, wanted a brilliant career, and I think I put the stops on it by coming along. A spoke in the works as far as he was concerned, something that he wasn't proud of. He's proud of everything else. He's not proud of me.
Unlike Tom, the acutely disabled Louise Mason was sent away to Chailey Heritage Hospital in Sussex.
My wife, as you may imagine, was not happy with this decision, and I had to be very, very firm and very definite about it, because we were only too well aware that people could in later life accuse us of having shelved our responsibilities. However, our decision at that time, in which my wife wholeheartedly joined after it was explained to her by our advisors and experts, we feel that that made her the person that she is today.
I was in Chailey for 17 and a half years. It was very hard for me to know the unwritten rules of what family life is like. Everything was done at a bell. You had a time for this, a time for that. Very routine, very much like a boarding school. When you're in an institution, you're one of many, so you don't have a chance to be a child as a child does. You don't have a chance to go up to somebody and get a cuddle, which, as you know and I know, is very, very important to children. So we had to grow up extremely quickly. In a sense, we didn't have a childhood. We had to grow up. We had to conform.
Right, Cad, come on, here we go. I'll have to hurry a bit this morning because we're a wee bit late, okay?
We're always late for school.
I know we're always late, but that's your fault.
You
shouldn't go to bed late, should you?
I go to bed late.
You do, you know.
While the institutional child was on her own, Kevin Donnellan always had his mother close at hand.
Now get scrub in the back as well, okay?
Well, when I was a kid, my mother did absolutely everything for me. Right, yeah, from basic washing and dressing, brushing my teeth, absolutely everything she did. And I didn't want for anything because, you know, I'm very grateful for what my mother did. She really sacrificed 22 years of her life looking after me. Right the way through my childhood, I was always protected from everything by my parents, almost wrapped in cotton wool, as it were. I really didn't feel any of the traumas that my mother was going through. I was blissfully unaware of it.
Andy Moore had a very different vision of childhood. Illegitimate and abandoned, childhood for Andy meant anger and confusion.
I thought I'd been punished in some way, or jailed, whatever, by some force. You know, at first I thought it was God, but then I wasn't sure who it was. I can really empathise with prisoners. You know, the isolation they feel, because I wanted to get out. I didn't know where I wanted to get out to, but I wanted to escape from it, because I knew how bad it was, because most of the kids knew that they weren't wanted in some way.
While in the institution, Andy Moore was trying to escape the imprisonment of his own body. Brett Nielsen's mother, caring selflessly for her demanding child at home, experienced another sort of incarceration.
I think, too, there's a certain amount of resentment at the amount of time and effort that one has to give to this child. I felt very guilty about it. I used to get so annoyed when he would ask me to, not ask, demand that I should do this and do that, when he would scream so much. But because the child was so handicapped, it seemed even worse to me to feel resentful.
Mrs. Nielsen's resentment and guilt was in no way unique. Within the isolation of their homes, the thalidomide parents were like beleaguered outposts, all feeling the same anger, but not able to share it.
Come over here, and you try the others.
Inside the home, the demands of disability were unremitting, but outside, there was even less relief.
When Brett was a tiny baby, I used to take him out to the shops and the clinic and whatnot, as much, or possibly more, than I used to take the other children, because I thought that let him get used to being stared at and poked, as some people do, right from birth, better to be used to half a dozen stairs every day of the week than to just suddenly get to half a dozen every Sunday. Old people are inclined to be most difficult to handle. Or sometimes people have come up in the street and said, did you take those drugs? They somehow think that one is a drug addict, a narcotic, mm-hmm. taking narcotics. And so they think that these mothers have brought this on the child themselves. And women have come up in the street and said, you ought to be ashamed of yourself. Look what you've done to that poor little child.
In the community I lived in, it got around, didn't it, like things do. And I dreaded the fact that I had to go out in the very beginning with her. I don't know why, whether I was disappointed or what, I don't know. But if I was going out for a walk or to the shops, people would stare terribly, especially, you know, when she was a few months old and sat up in her little pram.
I actually felt guilty on times of being there because I knew how much my parents hurt, what their emotions and feelings, anxieties and worries must have been for my present and my future. And I always tried to hide my own sad emotions to protect the people around me because I loved them as much as they love me. I wouldn't want to make them feel worse or saddened because I might have felt sad on times.
The idea of the family is the idea of intimacy. But for the handicapped child, the closeness was even closer.
I leant on her and she leant on me. We both became very, very close. I know that's hard to believe because she was a baby and I was her mother. There was times I didn't feel like her mother. I can't really explain what I mean. I just got this little thing that I felt I had to protect from the outside world.
These trousers have just about had it.
Inside the cocoon of the family, Kevin Donnellan could take his mother's love for granted. He was touched, he was cuddled, he was held. But outside the family, Louise Mason craved for the closeness and contact an institution, however caring, couldn't give.
And I used to misbehave, or I used to do something good just to be picked up and cuddled. And I used to spend a lot of time on the toilet because I'd ask the care staff to stay with me while I was on there because I didn't want to be left on. So I used to sit there in the toilet pretending I was doing something, and I probably wasn't, but just so that I could have the one-to-one contact.
She was a them and us to us. It was sort of like the people who were the nurses had power. They were the ones in charge. They said when you went to bed. And if you didn't like it, they'd pick you up and they'd carry you to bed, whether you wanted to or not. So that was a total feeling of powerlessness.
Most people thought that the damage was purely physical, but it went much deeper than that. So much of the normal cuddling between a mother and her baby was absent, and so many of the children became very deprived, institutionalized. They appeared friendly, but it was on the surface, it was rather like a sort of coat of varnish. There was no depth to them at all.
You're not born with love. You're taught it in your childhood, and if you've never had it or never been shown any intimacy, how can you give it? I used to give all my attention to animals. So at one time I had 6 hamsters to look after, 33 goldfish, 2 newts, a school hamster, gerbils. I just bathed myself in animals. I could give all my love to them. And they don't look at what you are. They'll always give you love.
One, two, three, four. Where's the other 10?
The doctors describe Kevin Donnellan as a thalidomide 4-limb deficient. In medical language, Kevin Donnellan would be classed with Louise. They fit the same category. But though on the outside, Kevin shares Louise's label, within, he occupies a very different world. He was the child of a family. But Louise now has a family she never had.
I was an orphan, but with parents. You can conquer arms and your own disability, but I think my main disability was the fact of lack of love. I mean, anyone can conquer not having legs and arms, but nobody can conquer not having love.
Divided the thalidomide generation, but a common experience for them all was that they were the focus of guilt. A guilt which began late in 1961.
I hammered on his door for about 5 minutes until I woke his entire household up. He came down, opened the door in his dressing gown, and I said, Doctor, you've got to help me. An awful thing has occurred. He took me into his surgery and asked the details, and I explained and described to him exactly what had happened. He slumped in his chair and said, oh my God, did I prescribe thalidomide? I had this double emotion at that time of joy that it was nothing to do with my genes or my wife's genes that had brought this terrible catastrophe about, but fury and anger that this had occurred because of a prescribed drug and by a drug company. But it wasn't only anger. I mean, I had to try and build a relationship with my daughter. I had to try and do something for her. What else could I do? I couldn't grow her new arms and legs.
And the evening papers tonight are talking, well, I'll quote you the headlines. It says, Our Anxiety by Distiller's Own Bankers. And it goes on to say of our meeting...
The campaign to make thalidomide's distributors, the distiller's company, accountable, though not exclusive to a single individual, was very much led by one man's anger. An anger outraged at the initial offer of £1 million to just 62 of the 450 victims, or in crew terms, £2,000. A leg.
This was a focal point for all my anger, for my frustration, for my wanting to do something for my crippled daughter, for me wanting to help my wife. I mean, what else could I do? However, it rapidly became a crusade for all the thalidomide children.
The campaign to make amends was not, however, just one man's crusade. The pressure to do something focused urgently upon the medical profession. But the problem for the doctors wasn't just urgent, it was new. Pediatrics was very much disease-based, but now thalidomide presented the medics with healthy children, who just happened to be the wrong shape.
The reaction of most of the doctors, surgeons, dealing with these babies was to try and put things right. One side of that was to take off any odd bits, so the tiny little sort of traces of limbs, little sort of fingers sticking out of the shoulders and things, they wanted to cut them off. In many cases they did, because we didn't know in those days that these fingers could be used by the children to do all sorts of things later on. The extraordinary thing to me was that so many of the mothers refused to have the bits taken off. They were horrified by them. And yet, instinctively, they wanted to keep them on the child. And of course they were right.
Anger.
Anxiety distorted our vision of these children. Obsessed by their lack of wholeness and missing parts, professionals blinded themselves to the simple fact of biology, adaptation. The mothers at home, however, were very quick to observe how toes could simply become hands.
I remember once when I was shopping with the old-fashioned sort of pram, I put some bananas in the bottom of the pram, and Elaine was strapped in at the other end and went off to do some more shopping. When I came out of the shop again, every banana was peeled, the skin was on the floor underneath, and she was quite happily eating through the whole bunch.
Well, one day we had a policeman knock on the door. And he said, "Can I see Peter?" I said, "Why?" He said, "Well, he's been throwing eggs at some boys." And these children's fence was over 7 foot high. So shouted Pete, and he come walking out, and Bobby looked at him. "Have you been throwing eggs?" "No." And he looked and he looked. "I'm going back over there," he said, "this Bobby." Suddenly realising Peter had no arms. But when all come to all, Peter had been throwing the eggs with his feet.
Despite all the evidence of adaptation, the parents still felt they had to seek out the professionals in the hope that science could repair their children's wholeness.
Let me see if you can press straight. See, if you press it one side, Brett, it comes up. If you press it the other side, it goes down. Now you press it with your chin.
German technology had taken away arms with its drug. Now, could it put them back with artificial limbs? Anxious British eyes turned to the experts from Heidelberg.
The Heidelberg arm. One is the rotation of the wrist, which the child can produce by pressing this switch. The second one is the flexion of the elbow.
The 60s seduction with technology led society to think that contraptions, not adaptations, were the answer. And anxious parents wanted to believe that the wonders of science could work miracles.
She was 3 at this stage. And this one day I went along and walked in the ward and said my hellos. And I looked and saw the curtains around Rosie's bed. And a nurse came running out from the office and said, "Oh, hang on a minute, Mrs. Moriarty. Don't go in yet." And I thought, gosh, what's wrong? You know, I thought she wasn't well or something. And then the next thing, the curtains drew back and this little girl walked towards me. And I just couldn't believe or explain the feeling. And here she was with her little rockers coming to meet me. Oh, I thought I was going to die. It's wonderful.
Looking at miracles was one thing, but being one, quite another. Hooked on their gadgets, the doctors had forgotten the patients. But the children soon discovered that technology's route to salvation was torture.
It's really hard for me to explain what it was like to use artificial arms and legs. To me, it was like in some dreams where you know you're there, but you can't actually touch anything. Like I could touch it, but it wasn't me touching, it was like somebody else was touching it and I was merely an observer. Being on legs, it was like being in suspended animation, tied with all these ropes, hanging in midair, like Peter Pan, but crashing all the time.
"Listen, how about if I put this sleeveless pullover on, darling? You haven't had the arm on for..."
"No!
Nearly enough. See, you're forgetting how to use an artificial arm now. Aren't you?
Not.
Come on, try it on with this sleeveless pullover, and then see how it is."
"No!"
The mothers for a time may have been seduced by technology, but the children themselves spotted what able-bodied society was up to.
"Where does it hurt?"
"On its shoulders."
I think the whole issue of artificial arms was not so much for the benefit of the child, but for the benefit of society as a whole. Looking back, I can't help but feel that through able-bodied eyes, that if you had bits missing, which
most of the little my children dead, then you weren't somehow quite whole. And to make you look normal and to make you appear whole to society, it helped to put these artificial arms on you. But in doing this, they were in fact handicapping or disabling the child more, because they were not allowing the child to use what limbs they had. They hadn't seen children using feet before, so it wasn't a sort of an option that they considered. They became blind to the child and the child's needs.
I think society was trying to mould me into look the same as everybody else. You know, they couldn't accept me the way I am, which is what I resented most. Society wanted me to look the way they looked, which is just a joke, really. They were just for cosmetic purposes rather than actual walk, and I could never walk in them.
Artificial legs were part of the uniform. You had to look whole as far as Chailey was concerned. You had to look a whole person. It was their policy. If you were able to wear legs and you could walk, you would have to walk.
Also, they were very dangerous. I mean, I was scared to death walking in them, especially at school where there's loads of kids running around the corridors. Because a slight push and I'd be flat on my face or on my head. And I frequently had stitches at the back of my head. So they were quite lethal.
Oh, I reckon I fell over about 50 times and I had over 100 stitches in my head or in my chin. The majority of the time was in my chin, so I'd stick my chin out like that to stop myself from smashing my face in.
So it was a complete irony that here they were trying to give you something to make you less disabled in the able body's eye, and yet they were making you far more disabled.
Come on, try on with this sleeveless pullover, and then see how it is.
While able-bodied society wanted the limbs on, the disabled child would do anything to take them off.
She's just screaming that loud that steam would be coming off her head.
Just that I didn't like to be made to wear them. I mean, it was just like everyone expected you to conform. Every other people expected you to have legs and be able to walk. Everybody else expected you to have arms and to be able to use them. And I didn't like that I had to conform. Why did I have to conform with everybody else? He hated them. I mean, apart from the fact that he could sort of poke them into his brother and you know, do him a bit of damage, was the only use he ever really found for them, you know? And in the end I thought, no balls to it. You either like me the way I am, or they don't like me at all. So I threw them in the wardrobe.
It's easy to be critical of the medical profession and forget the care and the effort of the many, especially at Chailey, who try to help. But for some children, the frustration with limbs bit even deeper. What really alienated them was to be regarded as objects.
Well, this one insensitive doctor came up to me and said, well, we're going to inject into your vein here on your chest. And he said, well, she won't be having children anyway because she's like she is. Which made me absolutely hysterical to feel that my body, even at the age of puberty, wasn't mine. I was just happened to be a mind inside this experiment.
In 1973, Louise Mason was a teenager. By then, the hopes once held for a daughter's mobility on artificial legs were fading. But in the same year, the father's long fight for compensation, along with that of the Sunday Times' Insight team, was crowned with success. Distillers have now come up with an acceptable offer.
And in the end, through hanging in and through being bloody-minded over it, we eventually obtained £32.5 million approximately for all the children. But of course, this brought about tremendous resentment with the other parents, who had wanted to accept the earlier offer of £3.25 million. I can understand it. They didn't have perhaps the financial independence that I enjoyed, so that I could turn down the initial offer that was £2,000 per arm and leg for Louise.
For the mothers at home, Coping with all the demands of a disabled child, it was instant relief that was wanted. So for many, the immediate need for a quick cash settlement, however derisory, took priority. Holding out for the children's long-term interests provoked great resentment.
In a way, I became a whipping boy for the other parents. There were bomb threats against my business. There were threats against my other children's lives. We received hate mail. We received abusive telephone calls. I was followed, that sort of thing. It was a terrible irony, really, that I never, ever got any peace from the other parents.
The final damages of around £30 million seem staggering. But when divided amongst all the beneficiaries, the average personal settlement each child received was just £18,000.
I realised that the money was not always a solution. In some cases, of course, it was absolutely wonderful. In the cases where they had an integrated family, it was all the difference between a cramped bedroom where they were all trying to struggle and lift, and a specially adapted flat. It was the difference between having a car and not having a car.
The compensation may have paid for expensive car conversions, but in human terms, the damages, paradoxically, could damage.
You see, suddenly there was enormous reversal. This vulnerable, this weak member of the family had suddenly become the power base. It was in their gift to give away the cars, to give away the house. They would have the money for the holidays. They were the ones who suddenly could bully their parents around, and sometimes they did.
I think when you've got a child who is able-bodied and that child turns around one day and says to you, I wish I'd been born with no arms and legs, because then I'd get what Jeanette gets. That is when it gets to a sad state of affairs. The people that cause this problem, I still like to think in my mind that they didn't realise they were causing it, to be totally honest. They helped to turn my daughter into a very, very selfish, self-centred person. For example, their attitude in life was, I don't owe you anything.
Oh, Liam Evans, you did not.
No amount of compensation could make amends for everything. There were some things money couldn't buy.
It was Clinton that went swimming, wasn't it?
But not all was disaster, even for the most alienated and unhappy. Suddenly, at the age of 7, Andy Moore discovered he was wanted.
Dad, I've got one!
What a nice little roach, my lad.
Quick, one last dish.
Put him back to it.
A poor Fenlon family adopted this thalidomide boy, and that adoption transformed his life. Andy Moore became Terry Wiles.
He wanted to be Terence with the two R's, and yet as soon as he was adopted with the two R's, then he just went down to Terry. But he would always say with the two R's, and I think it was very important to him to know that his name was completely changed.
I thought, well, if I change my name, I can change my outlook, and I can go to a more positive life. I might even get a second chance if I'm lucky. But also I would empower myself and would go more forward than backwards.
The adopted son released the father's inventiveness. A special feeding spoon helped him to eat. But what really intrigued Len Wiles was how he could get Terry more mobile. Unlike the professionals, however, this amateur wasn't hung up in the manufacture of a normal appearance. He accepted his son for what he was. In his back garden shed, this Fenlon lorry driver, using bits of an old window wiper motor, made a breakthrough which the professionals hadn't grasped. Wheels, not legs, were the answer.
You
This makes it go forward, this makes it go sideways, and backwards. If you push it hard on this way, this towards the table, and it'll go right round. If you push it on the other one, it'll go out right round the other way. Right, I'm going to go.
Freedom replaced imprisonment. He had space. Terry Wiles received the gift of mobility. But in giving, the parents also received.
People would say what we had done for Terry. I like to put it the other way and saying what Terry did for us. It gave us a purpose in life. We never dreamed that we would have a child, and Terry, he gave us joy.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Terry. Happy birthday to you.
Yes, it's in the straw at the bottom of the target.
Who, at the end of their childhood, was the thalidomide casualty? Wiles was the exception. But what was the rule?
Can you please put your hands together for Mr. Gary Skinner? Let's see now, put it.
Thank you. It's great working with the Muppets. Good evening. You're enjoying yourselves? I'll soon put a stop to that. Now,
to judge from just appearances, Gary Skinner, with his flipper arms, got away with thalidomide lightly. Like many comics before him, he didn't have the happiest of childhoods.
My dad used to work very, very long hours, because he used to be an investigative officer with the DHSS. And he'd arrive in late at night, and I'd be out playing with the rest of the kids. And I always used to remember he'd come down the street and he'd go into the house, undo his cuffs, roll his sleeves up, wash his hands, and the next move would be out into the street and shout, "Get it! In!" And I could never work out why all the rest of the lads were allowed to play out till 10:30, 11 o'clock. Yours truly was wrapped up in bed by 9:30 o'clock. But you could never say anything to him because he was a strict disciplinarian, and he'd give you the belt. Yeah, I may be painting a picture of him that he was an evil father. He wasn't. He was never that. But it was just to the extent of really, really, really overprotective. He was wrapped you in cotton wool.
Gary and his mother grew closer as the disabled son became the target for a father's overprotection and jealousy. Thalidomide could damage much more than arms. It could slowly annihilate a marriage.
I think love dies, and I think you felt as though you didn't have give him a perfect child, and he didn't have a perfect son, you know, and life just is cold, and nothing seemed the same again to me. We just seemed to, you know, grow apart.
Who was the casualty, looking back on it? The simple thought is that it was the child, but this really wasn't so. It was the child, it was the parents, it was the whole family. It was the other children in the family as well, who were very often neglected because of the special attention that was given to the thalidomide child. I didn't see a single family who I regarded were totally normal, ordinary. They were all damaged in some way or another.
From the time of Louise's birth, I've had this burden, and I've had this terrible complex fight and this awful feeling of what has occurred. I mean, it never leaves me. There isn't a day that goes by that I'm not reminded of it somewhere. And of course, when one looks back over the whole thing, one realizes that the victims of thalidomide, you didn't have a thalidomide child, you had effectively a thalidomide family.
I don't think you ever do really get over thalidomide. I mean, it's something that will never go away. It's there, isn't it? Well, you've got that child. You're a mother, so you'll never stop worrying about him.
The thalidomide story was not simple. For the Skinners, the drug destroyed a marriage. For Andy Mall, it broke a family. But as Terry Wiles, it created one.
A Cub Scout always does his best, thinks of others before himself, does a good turn every day. I promise that I will do my best, do my duty, to go to the Queen, to help other people and to keep the Cub Scout law.
Rosaline bears the marks of a dreadful myth, the myth of the perfect tranquilizer, thalidomide. Worldwide, its no known side effects unmade 8,000 children.
I was very pessimistic, very gloomy about the future for these children. And in my House of Commons speech in 1972, I said this. I didn't think that they would be able to manage at puberty. I didn't think they were going to have any normal sexual development. I didn't think they were going to get married. They'd never have families of their own. They'd never have children. I didn't think they would be able to lead ordinary careers. I was very worried for them indeed.
Of the 450 British thalidomides, 201 have married, they've produced 286 children, 70 have graduated, and 261 are in employment.
We were wrong that the children were going to be stupid. We were wrong that the artificial limbs were going to be tremendously helpful. In fact, the whole episode is education itself. We were wrong on practically every front.
In 1987, Louise Mason, four-limb deficient and 17 years in an institution, wore her artificial legs for the last time.
I decided that when I met John and we were going to get married, that we would do it traditionally and that I would wear my artificial legs so that I could be the same height as him and I could wear a pretty wedding dress.
I, Louise, take you, John.
I, Louise, take you, John.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health. To love and to cherish.
There's a story about thalidomide that we want to hear. It's a story like the phoenix of rising from the ashes. We can't have enough good news.
Can we have your husband John on with the baby?
We've always loved fairy tales, the happy family, living happily ever after. Their achievement comforts us, relieves our guilt. So is this the end of the thalidomide story? We may be relieved by disabled achievement, but what, 30 years on, do the thalidomide generation most want for themselves? Happily ever after for them would not to be them. They want to be us. Unanimously, all insist we are normal. We are you.
mean, as far as I'm concerned, my name's Peter Longstaff and I'm an individual. Simple as that. I mean, I don't want to be branded with anybody. I mean, branded a thalidomide then. Perhaps I'm a bit prejudiced towards them. Especially if I see somebody like myself. I cringe. Now that, I must admit, I find very, very difficult. Because in my own mind, I'm normal.
The conventional view of disability is that it's physical, the product of a damaged body. But those damaged bodies, in their capacity to adapt, conclusively show that they can do things. It's just that they do things differently. So the idea that disability is physical is an able-bodied myth.
Look at these poor girls, a job, you know?
Another myth about the disabled is that they are weak. Terry Wiles has had 30 years of being stared at. But one of the strengths of immobility for him has been time to stare back and notice what the able-bodied do to him.
Disability for me isn't all negative. In fact, a lot of it's positive, but I think the most positive thing that's come out of being disabled is being an observer. Because if you have to sit down all the time and you can't participate in life, you get to see a lot of what's going on. You get to think of the reasons behind it. What able-bodied people have got to realise is that disability isn't how I feel because the way I look. It's how you feel about me because of the way I look. That's what disability is about.
Elaine Whiting is studying for a sociology degree. But although she's a highly competent adult, she still finds that in the eyes of strangers, her armlessness makes her a moron.
People often talk to you as they would talk to a child. If I go into shops, I might be spoken to as if I'm a shilling short of a pound is perhaps the expression. Then they'll perhaps count the change out very slowly for you, as if you can't quite follow it. And I'm sort of there and finished before they've started.
So where does disability reside? In Elaine's armless body, or in our able-bodied minds?
The question really is, why does society need to stereotype disabled people? They have this image that disabled people are perhaps sad, they're lonely, they're somehow losers in life, and the favourite sort of stereotype is that they are childlike. By doing that, I think that people find disabilities very disturbing. They're frightened by them. If they can label them and pop the disabled person into one of those categories, then they can somehow control the situation and any sort of interaction they're having with that person. So thereby, their fear leads them into making stereotypes, and then they can gain control.
Can it be that, as well as being impressed by their adaptability, that we're also afraid of the disabled? Perhaps in their image, we see reflected all the anxieties we have about our own lives. Fears about being vulnerable. Fears about being sad, ugly, inadequate. And instead of admitting those fears, which we all share, do we just run away and simply dump them on a them, apart from us, the disabled? The idea of the happy ending avoids all these questions. But is there a thalidomide story that has not been told? How has this generation coped with the stereotypes designed by the able-bodied to reduce and enfeeble them? The idea of childhood is the idea of happiness, and most of the thalidomide generation loved their first 12 years. Disability hadn't happened. There was no them and no us. Even four limb deficients like Rosie were part of a gang.
I did have a very happy childhood, and people perhaps can't understand how a disabled person can have a happy childhood, but I did. As a child, I played with my sisters, I played with the local friends, I was in the gang when we lived not far from here on a little council estate, and we had little gully ways. We'd play hide and seek and such like, and it was often when it came to my turn to be hidden, one of them would pick me up and shove me in a bush, and the others would run off and, you know, just pretend for a few minutes that they didn't know where I actually was.
The thing about childhood is that no one ever wants it to end. So the disabled child, just like the able-bodied, was blissfully happy. So, if disability didn't begin at the beginning, when did it begin?
When I was a teenager and started going to like discos, and I was going to a nightclub when I was 16, I mean, you noticed then that that's when it did hit me that I was disabled. Like when my friends were getting up and they were dancing slow with the boyfriends, which I couldn't do.
You start worrying about whether you'll ever get a boyfriend, whether you'll ever get married, and all those kind of things that all teenagers go through.
The first time that my disability was brought home to me was when the master took us to one side as a class and said, now you're approaching the age of the three B's, birds, booze and bikes, and told us that those were the distractions that we were going to face in years to come. And I suppose that's when I first felt that those sort of things that my contemporaries would be able to get up to, I wouldn't be able to. I didn't think any girls would be interested in me. I didn't think I'd get served underage, and I certainly didn't think that riding a bike was going to be for me.
Adolescence didn't just threaten teenagers, it threatened adults. The rules of the ruling family were challenged by the teenage power of the tribe. Could the disabled child survive adolescence? In their lack of confidence for the future, some thalidomide parents, in their understandable anxiety, sought to perpetuate maternal protection by freezing their infant in childhood.
Yeah, I think the main problem started when I was approaching teenage. I stopped playing silly games with my mates and started looking at girls, really. And I wondered why the hell I was getting rebuffed all the time. And when I told my mother, she said, oh, well, stop chatting with girls, because you'll never get married. I don't know whether the doctors had told her or whether she believed it herself, but she said I was infertile. So I just naturally assumed I was as well. And that really hit me very, very strongly. I don't really resent my mother for saying that now, because I think she was genuinely trying to protect me from being hurt.
The demon drink, as well as sex, really frightened Kevin's parents. And in their protective anxiety, they went to the colossal expense of building a bar in their basement to keep the outside world away from their child.
I mean, the more protective my mother was, the more rebellious I'd be, and the more I'd resent her, really. And things, you know, would come to, you know, quite heavy arguments, really. I mean, I usually just go out with my mates and sort of assault them. I don't care. I'll stay out all night, I'll get drunk if I want. I don't really care. I mean, mates would leave me on the doorstep and run like hell, ring the bell and run away. And I'd be drunk on the doorstep and, you know, there'd be hell to play in the next day.
Unlike Kevin, Louise was an institutional child. She'd spent 17 years here at Chailey Heritage. For her, adolescence was easy. Whereas in childhood, absent parents had disabled her. Now at 18, to have no meddling father and mother around was a positive advantage.
When I left Chailey, I went wild. Absolutely wild. I'd go to the pub, I'd be absolutely paralytic. I would have my breakfast at night time, my night meal at breakfast time, so my clock was all turned upside down. And when I'd got to college, all of a sudden, everyone was different, everyone was new. So I started exploring with the boys and exploring pubs and doing everything that I shouldn't do. I went to parties, just for the sheer hell of going to the parties. I'd be absolutely cream crackered, but I'd still go, because it was something that I shouldn't have done or wasn't allowed to do. I was trying to cram all my adolescence into, what was it, a year.
Thalidomides, the ultimate adolescent experience, wasn't booze, it wasn't sex, it was speed. And their group car insurance in those first motoring years assumed they would have 1.5 accidents a week. 90% of all thalidomides have passed the driving test. Controlling a perfect body, competing on equal terms, how could they resist?
It was the first time ever that I'd totally been in charge of a situation. And it was just such a great feeling, on equal terms with everybody else. When you're away, such freedom.
Childhood ended at the wheel. Mobility brought freedom, an escape from parental protection, the imprisonment of always being children. But just as one stereotype passed, another arrived. Today, our view of the thalidomide generation has totally flipped. Hopelessly vulnerable, now never cease to amaze us. So, if their first disability was to be reduced to mere children, their second was to be turned into supermen.
I give you all my love, this day and every day, forever and forever. In our joys and in our pain.
Born without arms, Tony Melendez has learnt over the years to play the guitar with astonishing dexterity with his feet. Until earlier this year, it was a skill few knew about outside of his native California.
We become the sign of love our God has given us.
In September, he was thrust into the national spotlight when he performed before the Pope in Los Angeles. Tony will never forget how the Pope worked his way through the crowd to hug him.
And then he starts coming towards me and just, you know, I just sat there where I was at and I didn't know what to do, you know, I just sat there. I was really amazed.
Does a skeptical 20th century so need icons that it uses the triumphant thalidomide to give it a sense of belief?
Without your love,
triumph and inspiration hardly seem possible for this sad little boy, illegitimate, abandoned, and forelimb deficient. But at the age of 9, quite out of the blue, this unloved child was rescued. A poor Fenland family adopted him. Terry Wiles started a second life.
I promise that I will do my best, do my duty, come to the Queen, to help other people and to keep the Cub Scout law.
But Terry Wiles was more than loved. He became a project, releasing a father's inventiveness. In a homemade wheelchair, a son was born again. But Terry's second life quickly snowballed into a third. The fairy story of a frog turned into a prince was picked up by a journalist. And by her magic, a tiny boy grew into a giant.
I first met Terry and Len and Hazel in 1972. I was working on the Sunday Times. And I went up and I went to their little cottage. They were in a tiny little cottage in the middle of the fens. And it was a foggy November day. And we searched around this little cold cottage for something to eat. And there was just one tin of steak and kidney pie, which had to go around all of us. Really, they were living, they were a tiny, fragile, very beleaguered little family. And I couldn't believe at the time, really such poverty, people living like that on the edge of life. But there was something absolutely extraordinary about them. They did have a fighting spirit and imagination and invention, and I knew that would make a marvellous story, so I wrote that up in the Sunday Times.
The Terry Wiles story was perfect copy for the campaign to win damages. So the Wiles inspiration began in the newspapers, grew into a book, and finally took off as a film.
I went to the BBC and I said, look, I've got this wonderful story. And they said, well, who's going to play a 2-foot-high, armless, legless, one-eyed person? And I said, well, Terry himself, of course.
Look where you're going!
Careful, Kevin.
Are you going out for a ride now?
That's right, Andy. Just for a short ride.
Where are you going to take me?
To a cab. Can we get him out of these things? Is that allowed?
I'll go and get him changed.
On Giant Shoulders was a colossal success. With these images, the Wiles inspiration took off. Ripples of fame crossed the Atlantic, and this simple Fenlon family were tempted to California with irresistible offers. A workshop for Len, and for Terry, a university place. But the hopes that were dangled never really materialized. Sadly, in America, the dreams fell apart.
There was this lure of Long Beach, and there was all the glitz of Hollywood, and they wanted to get into that media world. And at the same time, you kind of knew that that wasn't really the best for them.
Was a way to hell paved by a journalist's good intentions? Marjorie Wallace had spotted not just a great story, but that Terry's image could be used as a symbol to raise consciousness for the plight of all the other thalidomide children.
Because people could see, there was this boy without arms, without legs, one eye, 2 foot high. But he was normal and bright and intelligent and funny. And that probably transformed the attitude to disabled people all over the world, to all the places the film was shown and the book went. And in a way, is that right or is it wrong? Is there always a sacrificial victim? Do people pay the price to help other people?
Yesterday's inspiration today is forgotten. He's out of work, living far away in New Zealand, on the other side of the world. Terry Wiles' story is a parable. Terry has had to bear not just the pains of thalidomide. His cross was more dreadful, to be an inspiration. Kevin Donnellan, like Terry Wiles, has had his share of media attention. He's been featured in 3 World in Action documentaries. But what has all this TV exposure done to his generation?
Thalidomide people from day one really have been in the attention of the media. We really are put on pedestals, people call us heroes, and it's like being under a magnifying glass almost. You know, everything we do is almost scrutinised. Like if you pass your driving test, you're in the papers or whatever, or you're thrown on Wogan. I don't feel myself an inspiration. It's very difficult to live to that image, really. I'm quite bemused by it all, because I really don't think I'm anything special. I just happen to be disabled, yes, but I mean, I haven't really achieved anything, you know. I haven't got a job, I'm not married. I haven't achieved anything in that respect.
In its search for the heroic, television ignores the mundane. The disabled don't want to be extraordinary. Freedom for them is to be like everybody else.
People have often questioned me about my ambitions in life, and my ideal ambition was just to be like an ordinary Mr. Average bloke, married with like 2 kids and a semi-detached house somewhere and a steady job. And I think I had a desire to be ordinary because I wasn't treated in an ordinary manner. Or rather, the expectations of me weren't really ordinary.
The ordinary experience of many thalidomides is redundancy. 1/3 of this generation are like Kevin and are unemployed. So despite all the hype, the selling of supermen, do we still think they're children, inadequates, incapable of holding a job? redundancy doesn't much interest television. It wants performers, not the ordinary, the dullness, the frustrations of thalidomide life. But for Heather Clark, paradoxically, it was a media experience that gave her, at least for a day, a sense of escape. Heather has jumped from the heavens, but what of life on Earth? We applaud the daring, call them inspirations. At the same time, by denying them opportunities to properly enter our world, prove that we still think they're inadequate, mere children. Gripped between two stereotypes, the able-bodied have their thalidomides both ways.
There you go.
People often ask me why I do water skiing, and the answer is because I love danger, I love living on the edge. I know I'm disabled, but there is no reason why the disabled should be wrapped in cotton wool.
Legless achievement may comfort us, but in their overachievement, do the thalidomide generation express doubt, fear that unless they do the impossible, they will never gain full membership of the able-bodied world.
I've never ever thought of myself as being a disabled person, because to me I'm not. I can do everything that I've ever wanted to do. A lot of people would imagine that I couldn't possibly do a groom's job. And it's absolutely maddening, is people who will keep saying to me, well, who looks after your horses for you? As if they imagine I have a little band of helpers that do everything. And I sometimes, no matter how I explain, I cannot get them to believe me that I do it all myself. I have to prove to people time and time again it anything can be done. And what I've always wanted to do is ride and compete and win. And I've done all those things. So to me, I'm definitely not a disabled person.
Six roll. Here we go, cue Lisa.
Good morning. There's been an increase in fighting across the desert front line, with American and Iraqi armour clashing in seven engagements.
Super. The life of a television director isn't always calm. We really do have some hairy days, and to mind springs the day Iraq invaded Kuwait. I was actually working that morning, and I've never seen my toes move so fast trying to shuffle scripts. And that really was the day that I realised that, yes, I could become a news director, and I could hack it with the best of them. Society tends to look at physically different people as being losers, you know, that stereotype of all blondes must be dumb, you know, all academics can't boil an egg, and all physically different people are losers. Succeeding has a lot to play in the way I look at the world. I went to Seoul in 1988 for the Paralympics and only came fourth in the swimming competition, and it took me about 7 months when I came back from that trying to cope with the fact that I had lost a race, that I had not come back from Seoul with a medal. Psychologically, it took me ages and ages to come to terms with, you know, that not, and it didn't just affect my sporting life, it affected my entire life. I just went around going, my God, I never thought I would come back with nothing.
When we look at the disabled, the nothing we think they'll come back with isn't medals, it's relationships. In the roughest of all competitions, the one for partners, we can't imagine how they dare enter, let alone win.
I mean, you can't tell a book by its cover. You can't tell a person by the way they look. And once people get to know you and find you for your true self, It's all right, they don't have any problems. They don't look upon you as being disabled.
In the competition for relationships, the thalidomide generation have refused to be losers. But each individual has had to face the handicap of their own body in their own particular way.
I look in the mirror to see my face, but I try and avoid mirrors to look at me as a whole, mainly because I don't see myself as I am. I see myself as normal. I mean, you at Christmas, somebody give you a big parcel. You're not really worried on what's on the outside and what kind of wrapping paper it's in. You're more interested in what the thing is inside the present.
Appearance is really important to me. I suppose it's generally in my nature anyway, but I always like to have my makeup on if I'm going anywhere nice and wear smart clothes.
For appearance's sake, Heather wears cosmetic legs, which, because they're not functional, demand that she's carried to her car. So some thalidomides prefer to aggravate their physical disability as a price worth paying for the confidence the image of wholeness can bring.
There are gains and losses with the legs, but they make me feel a whole person. Without them, I have no confidence.
Whereas some thalidomides disguise their bodies and others hide from them, Kevin Donnellan openly announces his shape. It in no way feels the girls have passed him by.
I've been surprised myself that, you know, since I left home, I've been quite successful with girlfriends. I've had like 3 steady relationships. I mean, the girl I'm going out with now, I've been with for 3 years. I mean, people suggested to me, you know, why didn't I look for disabled girlfriends? And I thought, well, why the hell shouldn't I be choosy on who I want to go out with? But I mean, I wouldn't rule out not going out with anyone disabled, but I mean, the girls I've, you know, that have come into my life just haven't been. And the girls I've fallen in love with haven't been either. I've always been very much interested in politics, things like the peace movement, the CND rallies. And it was just thrilling for me to take part in that. Because again, it wasn't like me in a wheelchair, it was just like me with all my comrades fighting for peace and justice. I think able-bodied people feel much more comfortable if we were just passive, sitting in wheelchairs and just being bottle-fed, basically, or just living the life they want us to live and not having any opinions about anything. Or not being active in politics or active in society.
Well, then I will have to arrest you for criminal damage to the fence. I do not have to say anything unless you...
Well done,
and I thought, yeah, it's great. I'm going to be prosecuted. I'm going to sit in court and say my piece. And then about a week later, I got a letter off the Chief Constable of Cheshire saying they weren't going to take any further action in this matter. And I was really angry because, you know, you might think it was great being let off because I'm disabled, but I was really annoyed because I felt they were patronising me. They didn't want a disabled person speaking out against nuclear missiles in the court of law. Yeah, in this society, disabled people really aren't allowed to be rebels, and they certainly aren't allowed to be punished for the wrongs they do or whatever. And I think even more importantly, they're not allowed to have a political conscience.
Please put your hands together for Mr. Gary Skinner. Let's see it now, put it.
Thank you. It's great working with the Muppets. Good evening. You're enjoying yourselves?
Yes.
I'll soon put a stop to that. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I shouldn't really be here tonight because I've just lost a wife. What a game of cards that was. I was doing a pub in Soxley the other night. Somebody threw a petrol bomb through the window. Some bugger drank it before it went off. Tell ya, talking about double glazing.
I've always wanted fame as a comic. I want to be up there with the Jimmy Tarbucks and, you know, Yelena Henrys and people like that.
He said, no, he said, I've come about your double glazing. I said, we don't want that, we've got it. He said, no, you have, you've had it for 5 years and you've paid bugger all. I said, that's your fault. He said, my fault? Why is it my fault? I said, well, when you sold me it, you said it paid for itself in 6 months.
I've got one of the top managers in the Northwest who's looking after me. And to me, it seems like we're knocking on the door now. We're nearly there. And I think with just a little bit more of a push and possibly a little bit more luck, we're going to get there. And that's my vocation in life, is to be famous and rich and wealthy and to get there and to say, well, look, I've done it.
Destined for the great entertainment venues of Europe, we bring you rising stars from across the land, and we'll discover the new stars of tomorrow on Sky Star Search.
Now, I'll tell you what, though, we don't half get clobbered up in the Northwest, don't we, through one thing or another day. That Margaret Thatcher, the only cow that doesn't give milk. But Cecil Parkinson and MFI got in common. One loose screw and the old cabinet falls apart. Just to leave you, I'd like to leave you a bit of thought. If sardines are so full of nutrition, vitamins and things that are good for you, why is it when you open a tin, they're all dead? Ladies and gentlemen, if you've enjoyed that tonight, it was Gary Skye, and if you didn't, it was Jimmy Tarbuck. From me to you, good night, God bless, thank you.
And of course, you've got what all good Liverpool comedians have, is attack, and it's a terribly overworked word, but charm. And it makes it twice as funny and twice as acceptable. I thought you were great. 39 points.
39 points from Leslie!
How'd you find your bow tie? I just lifted three chins and there it was.
Although Gary Skinner impressed on Sky, he's never quite made it on Earth. He just can't break into the big time.
Grazie, amigo. And constantly get told, no, no, no. I often sit down and wonder why. It seems to me that if I give out the most brilliant performance, the most unblemished performance, he would still, the producer of Opportunity Knocks or New Faces, would say no. And they seem to think that disabled people should be put in a corner somewhere and get in their three-wheeler car, drive away and be a good boy, and we'll pat you on the back of the head, and if you want a handout, we'll give you a handout. But please, it's not your department to make us laugh.
You know the first night we take you out, girls? Tell the truth now. Don't we try hard, lads. Don't we try hard. Best suit on, shirt, tie, smell of aftershave. I don't know all that. So we do a big restaurant in Liverpool, pull the chair out for her, sat her down and I give her the menu. I said to her, do you like scampi? She said, I like all them friggin' Disney films.
I remember thinking and feeling, probably when I was about 18 or 19, that the reason that I was disabled was because God was punishing me for something which I had done. I think I almost felt anger as well that people could talk about a God of love. Who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples. I think that the thought that God was punishing me was resolved very much by my conversion experience, which I had when I was at university. It hit me with a terrific new force that God really did love me. And he loved me so much that his son died for me on the cross. And that's when I thought, far from God punishing me, God was using and could use my physical disability. Sometimes I've heard people say, oh, we think you're wonderful and marvellous, how you cope and you do that. I think people put me on a bit of a pedestal and see me as an inspiring figure, if you like. And I don't find that very helpful, because it almost implies that I'm looking down at them and they're looking up at me. And so I can find that it's very disabling, as it were, to have a gulf fixed between myself and other people by their attitudes, because it's almost as if they say, well, it's all right for him. He would find Christian faith very comforting, but it's not for me. And what I am trying to show is that I'm just like everybody else on the inside, and I may look different, but on the inside I'm just like them.
No ideal is more sublime than motherhood. So when Elaine, at 18, produced the first child born to a thalidomide victim, the media absolutely lunged at the opportunity to sell its tabloid vision of the Holy Family.
And I really was sort of put on a pedestal and almost worshipped as the perfect mum. And it was something I found very hard to bear. It was very, very difficult to sort of live up to those standards.
Seven years after her first marriage, Elaine became fodder for the news of the world. By then, she'd been divorced twice and was about to marry for the third time. Overnight, the tabloid vision of perfect motherhood flipped. A saint metamorphosed into a sex kitten.
Because I was disabled and I had a normal sex life and the normal sort of tribulations of marriage and divorce, it was somehow portrayed in this article as kinky. And it was quite incredible, really, that from being sort of an angel 7 years on, I was a fallen angel.
Good morning, A-Team Christmas Gram Company. Hello, Jim. Yeah, I've got them two for you. I've got the girl here in the office now. She's tall, blonde, very well suntanned. Make Madonna look cheap. Yeah, lovely looking girl. She'll do that for you. I've also got the lad here.
As well as being a successful club comedian, Gary is a partner in a kissogram agency. He markets titillation.
We've got a girl on the books who's 22 stone, who does the roly-poly grams, but the girls who we get most call for are the topless ones who have to be, obviously, in the Dolly Parton mould. Not that big, obviously, but along them lines. All right, mate, I'll see you soon. Thanks, Jim. Bye now. Bye-bye.
Selling desire to the able-bodied is one thing, but how do the disabled handle their own desirability when, in a world of page three, they are relegated to asexual objects?
Well, when I first met Bob, people say, like, love at first sight, but in my case it was lust at first sight.
If you're severely physically disabled and you're stuck in one spot and you can't let your feelings out in this particular way, what do you do? I mean, how do you handle it? I mean, do you deny it, which a lot of people with disabilities do? Or do you express it? And I wanted to express it, because I knew if I didn't, it would destroy me. So the area that I used prostitution.
Just because I haven't got the body of somebody like Bo Derek doesn't mean I'm any less good than she is, whether it's in bed, out of bed or whatever.
If you're no good at one thing, you might be excellent at another. Well, this is something that I found that was very common in thalidomides. It's something they were all good at, male, female, alike. They were all had a high sex drive.
I mean, when I was an adolescent, there was nothing wrong with my hormones. I mean, they bounced off the walls just like everybody else's.
Adolescence for the thalidomide generation was more than 10 years ago. But now, what they desire is more than desire. Today, what most of them see, and half have achieved, are permanent relationships. In New Zealand last year, Terry Wiles married Robin. She, like him, had wanted release from a failing first marriage and a lifetime of misery and suicide attempts. So, do disabilities disappear when united?
What we noticed about each other was it's a tribal thing. Like, I think as a person with a disability, I'd often felt isolated even from my own tribe, and that Robin and I were from the same tribe because we'd both been oppressed, but with each other we sort of exorcised those oppressions. So it was like a cancelling out of oppression. Yeah. We've realised both that we're kindred spirits,
yeah,
and that we have very similar backgrounds, and because of that, that's wiped both slates clean, and now we're starting together on a second life together.
I was desperately trying to put my life in order, but I needed someone to do that with. I wanted someone to share the rest of my life with. I mean, sure, you can do it on your own. I'd come a long way, but I'd reached the point where I wanted a soulmate.
Is marriage an escape? A release from disabling stereotypes? Or simply a confirmation of them? Significantly, amongst the thalidomide generation, it's disabled men who have married able-bodied women, but it's far less common the other way around. In 1990, Steve Mackay who'd spent 16 years in an institution, married Sue.
I can often see that some women married to disabled men perceive them as children, mother them, and have rather a strong maternal instinct and a very repressed sexuality. People who don't know Steve and I make a lot of assumptions about our relationship based purely on what they see. They tend to perceive me as some sort of caring angel looking after Steve rather than a wife in the normal sense of the word. For me, marrying Steve was nothing like that. I fell in love with him the same as any other person would, and marrying him was a positive choice. I think in our society, where women are afforded little respect and disabled people are afforded even less respect, our relationship redresses the balance of power, and we find that it's a very egalitarian thing.
Who can the disabled trust? In a risk business like marriage, won't the able-bodied run away? Rosie and Stephen are two of the six British thalidomides who have married each other.
And I think what helped to cement the relationship was a special trust and understanding and a certain extra bonding which perhaps you wouldn't always have if I'd married an able-bodied person. I may be worrying at the back of my mind, would they suddenly find that they no longer like being with a disabled person, that they may go off, leave you and marry an able-bodied person because they were missing out on something. But it's something as little as not being able to put your arms around your husband. Steve can honestly say that that doesn't worry him.
Of the 201 thalidomides who have married, the vast majority have not married the disabled. They've chosen able-bodied partners. Is that a victory, to win the able-bodied? A mark of escape from the disabled tribe? Today, where are they now? 30 years on, the new experience for thalidomides is parenting. So what happens when unmade bodies produce a child that is whole? Disability doesn't have to begin at the beginning. In fact, for Jeanette, the first four-limb deficient ever to have a baby, its start was delayed for 25 years.
It's only when I actually became a mother that I realised I was physically disabled. Because when my daughter cried and she was in the cot beside the bed and she happened to be crying, I couldn't bend down and pick her up. But it was so frustrating not being able to do what normally a mother should be able to do. Like pick a baby up when it's crying, hold it, cuddle it, feed it. If I fed her, she was sick because the way I held the bottle. So that in the end I couldn't do. It ended up that my mum and my husband did most of it. But just simple things like that, that I couldn't do, that really then showed me that I was disabled.
Stand up, Em.
Em, where's Snoopy?
Where's Snoop?
You gonna get Snoopy for me?
Where's Snoopy?
And I'm sure every mother would agree, there's nothing better than you first pick a baby out of a bath and wrap it in a towel and hold it. There's nothing, you know, it's just that special moment. They haven't got any outside skin on. You know, it's their bare skin. It's hard to explain what a nice feeling it is. But I felt very, very jealous that somebody else had this intimate experience, which I personally could not have. The first contact that my daughter had wasn't with her mother. It was with, as far as I'm concerned, a total stranger. I felt very, very bitter.
What other colour?
The story of thalidomide begins with a child and ends with a child. One day, Kellyanne will understand how her birth disabled a mother, but enabled a grandmother's sadness to pass away.
25 years. I've carried so much guilt about. And now Jeanette got this perfect baby girl. And to me, I knew that that was going to be my job, was helping bring this baby up for her. I didn't resent it one way. And all I wanted to do was just hold and love her. And I had 7 minutes with that baby on my own. That's the best 7 minutes of my life. I don't know, I just can't explain them. And I felt so much better afterwards. The most wonderful day of my life, that was.
She was lovely and fair, like the roses of summer. But it was not her beauty
to end with, I always say a saying from Alice Through the Looking Glass when she met a unicorn, and she said, "Oh, I didn't know there were creatures like you." And the unicorn turned round to her and said, "Well, if you believe in me, I shall believe in you."